Okay, well, a very warm welcome to Dorset Humanists this afternoon, especially if it's your first time. And if you'd like to know any more about Dorset Humanists, then do please have a look at our website. So, as I say, I've put everyone on mute for the duration of the talk. When I was talking to David Pearce, our speaker, earlier on, he did say that, that he will welcome questions and interjections possibly as we go along, although he's going to speak first of all, and then I'm sure he'll indicate when he's ready to take any questions. And so if you want to ask a question or make a comment, you need to find the little blue hand symbol, which is, let me just remind you how to do that. You need to go to participants at the bottom of the screen and click the button which says raise hand. We're going to let David speak first of all, and then we'll let you know when we're ready to start taking questions. And after the meeting, I'll let the meeting or the event run on a little bit afterwards as well, if people would like to stay and chat. But I guess as it's quite a nice sunny day, you'll probably be very happy to go out into your garden or wherever you can get some fresh air. Okay, well, I'm going to just introduce our speaker now. Our speaker is David Pearce, and David is a prominent figure in the transhumanism movement, which advocates transforming the human condition through technology. He's the author of The Hedonistic Imperative, which outlines how pharmacology, genetic engineering, nanotechnology, and neurosurgery could eliminate all forms of unpleasant experience from both human and non-human life, replacing suffering with gradients of bliss. And he calls this the abolitionist project. In 1998, he co-founded the World Transhumanist Association with Nick Bostrom, which is now known as Humanity Plus. So if you know where the reactions button is on your screen, you could go to the reactions button now and give our speaker a warm welcome with the yellow clap. Okay, so we're getting some claps, David, already. So a very warm welcome. And so over to you, David. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, David. It's very good to be with you, Dorset Transhumanists. Still suffering a bit from corona brain, I'm afraid, but I'm 99% recovered. Essentially, as you're indicating, I'm a transhumanist. What is a transhumanist? And broadly, there are three big currents of transhumanism. It's a very disparate movement. But one of them is, superintelligence, this idea that we can radically augment our intellectual capacities in the broadest possible sense and become transhuman, ultimately post-human superintelligence. Then there's a second super, this is super longevity. This is the idea that just as silicon robots can be reprogrammed, repaired, and upgraded indefinitely, there is no reason in principle why we can't do the same for organic robots, so that humans can lead indefinite, healthy, youthful lifespans. And I believe David Wood is going to be speaking to Dorset transhumanists soon. But there's a third current of transhumanism, and this is the current that I mainly focus on, I confess. This is the idea that it's going to be possible to use biotechnology, in particular genetic engineering and AI, to phase out the biology of suffering throughout the living world and replace the kind of information signaling system based on the conventional pleasure-pain axis, which horrendous forms of suffering, misery and malaise, with an information signaling based on gradients of intelligent bliss. That essentially that the whole biosphere is now programmable, and that what matters is not merely the well-being or the suffering of one particular species, Homo sapiens, but essentially we want to re-engineer the biosphere so we can create the well-being of all sentience. Now, this is, yeah, it's a very ancient goal in one sense, from Buddhism to various traditional ideologies, utopian schemes. But what's different now is that it's possible, at least in outline, to sketch how this is technically possible, and more cautiously, how it's actually going to happen. But as I said, please, don't feel you're interrupting me. Stop me at any stage. Ask questions or objections. Yeah, essentially, first of all, let me just perhaps outline, you know, the problem in a sense, and why the problem of suffering seems just so insuperable. I mean, right now, tragically, there are hundreds of millions of people who are experience some form of pain or pain disorder. Yeah, I hope everyone right now is feeling comfortable and not in in any form of physical pain. But pain is truly ghastly, and unfortunately, with our existing genome, it's inevitable. So yeah, that's one big problem we need to tackle, the problem of physical pain. Then there is psychological pain, mental pain. And sadly, in spite of the tremendous advances we see in civilization, technical progress, there is the so-called hedonic treadmill. The hedonic treadmill is this suite of negative feedback mechanisms in the brain that stop most of us being very miserable or very happy for too long. But yeah, essentially, nature did not design us to be happy. Other things being equal, being discontented a lot of the time is actually good for our genes, even if it's psychologically bad for us. But back on the African savannah, for example, anyone who sat around counting their blessings, or a kind of relaxed, contented mother who was sure that all would be right for her offspring, and she didn't leave as many copies of her genes as the ultra neurotic, anxious mother constantly seeing lions on the horizon. And yeah, the hedonic treadmill is tremendously powerful, which is why, there's the lottery paradox. Six months after having a terrible accident that leaves one quadriplegic or winning the lottery, most people will have reverted to their default level of well-being or ill-being before the tragedy or the great win. That's not to say that everyone is the same. Some people are lucky. They have a relatively high hedonic set point, this default setting around which they tend to fluctuate in the course of a lifetime. Other people are less lucky. They have a low hedonic set point. Indeed, there are some people who spend most of their lives below hedonic zero, gradients of misery. But any solution to the problem of suffering that tackles will need to tackle the hedonic treadmill and ratchet up hedonic set points. And we know originally from twin studies that hedonic set point, hedonic range, has a very high degree of genetic loading. And now that we have essentially decoded the human genome, we are starting to tease out the molecular biological details. Now, I'm not in this discussion talk going to be discussing all the socio-political reforms that are going to be needed for the abolitionist project to come to fruition. It's a twin track approach. But what I want to stress is that unless we are actually prepared to tackle the biological genetic roots of suffering, then essentially, yeah, in 500 years' time or 5,000 years' time, our successors will be sitting around and saying, well, why aren't we happy? Why are we so discontented a lot of the time? So I mentioned how the abolitionist project will have to, well, ethically, morally, should extend to the rest of the living world. And the easiest way to do this is would be simply to shut down factory farms and slaughterhouses, probably the greatest source of severe, readily avoidable suffering in the world today. But also, animal abuse tends to lead to kind of terrible global pandemics too. But realistically, this is probably going to happen rather than everyone simply going vegan. It's going to happen via a cultured meat revolution. Cultured meat is artificially produced meat that can be genetically identical, identical taste and texture and genetic composition to meat as it exists today, but produced without cruelty. And the final stage of the abolitionist project, at least on Earth, will be tackling the horrendous suffering in nature. Now, naively, that probably sounds impossible. I mean, you know, it sounds biologically illiterate. How are you going to abolish starvation and predation? But, and we can go into this later if anyone is interested, these are all technical problems with technical solutions. Well, what's more, solutions that can be explored with recognizable extensions of existing technologies. I'm not invoking godlike superintelligence or anything like that. For this to happen, what is going to be absolutely critical is for us to alter our own genetic source code. Now, a lot of people are extremely uncomfortable about this, perhaps with good reason. After all, one thinks of 20th century, first half of the 20th century, the eugenics movement, which started off with good intentions, but ended up to the horrors of the euthanasia program and the Third Reich. And in any case too, a lot of people are extremely uncomfortable with the idea. Isn't this genetic experimentation with kids? But I mean, the point I would really like to emphasize is that if one considers it ethically justifiable to bring new life and suffering into the world, one is, in a sense, committed to a form of genetic experimentation. I mean, this is what sexual reproduction involves. And at the moment, it's a genetic crapshoot. You know, two people get together, make love, kid appears, and one hopes that the results are going to be positive. I'm not personally convinced genetic experimentation, which is what sexual reproduction is, can be ethically justified because there is no prior consent. But let's not go down the antinatalist route. Let's assume that we accept that, yeah, people are going to want to continue having kids indefinitely. The very nature of selection pressure suggests that there will be this very, very powerful urge to have children and reproduce. And so the question I think one wants to ask is, should we continue the genetic crapshoot, or should we actually choose benign genes, benign alleles and allelic combinations for our future children to load the genetic dice, to give them the best possible start in life? And such traits as pain sensitivity and hedonic set points are amenable to genetic control and genetic manipulation. And already in China, we're seeing the first now designer babies, not an unfortunate term, but it's the one that seems to be quite standard. Starting with pain sensitivity, this isn't just airy-fairy philosophical speculation. I mean, consider the so-called volume knob for pain. the SCN9A gene. Now, the SCN9A gene has dozens of different alleles. Nonsense mutations of SCN9A completely abolish the capacity for experiencing pain. Unfortunately, they also abolish nociception too. And anyone born with a nonsense copy of SCN9A has to lead a cotton wool existence, or else they damage themselves in all sorts of ways. I mean, it's particularly damaging if one has a nonsense mutation of SCN9A and has congenital analgesia if one is male, because males tend to be greater risk takers. But before thinking of abolishing any form of physical pain altogether, which we can come to if we're interested later, but yeah, isn't what I'm currently talking about. If instead we ensure all future children are born with benign, crudely low pain alleles of the SCN9A gene, we can guarantee that all future humans enjoy the kind of pain thresholds, pain sensitivity of today's hedonic genetic outliers. I don't know if you've ever met the kind of person who says, oh, pain, it's just a useful signaling mechanism, and so on. These are high-functioning people. They still have the function of nociception, but nonetheless, pain just isn't really very significant in their lives. I mean, tragically, there are other versions of SCN9A where one is much more sensitive to pain, and this can be extremely debilitating. But yeah, I mean, lots of other alleles are involved in pain processing too. One could explore them too. There is the Jo Cameron case, who she was reported recently. This is a Scottish woman, retired vegan school teacher, who has almost unique double mutation of the far and far out genes, newly discovered far out genes. They regulate them levels of an anandamide, which is from the Sanskrit for bliss, this endogenous cannabinoid in the body. She essentially has, you know, is socially responsible, vegan, retired Scottish school teacher, has gone through her life, but she has negligible sensitivity to pain. She is almost always happy and never gets depressed. There are a number of different interventions we can contemplate. There are all sorts of risks one needs to consider too, i.e. if someone has an extremely elevated pain threshold, will they engage in all kinds of risky behavior? But essentially, pain sensitivity is an adjustable parameter. Now, in the case of hedonic tone and hedonic range, I mean, we all know that people who are, as psychiatrists would say, hypothymic, i.e. they are temperamentally extremely happy and optimistic, extremely high hedonic set point, their quality of life tends to be much higher than people who are either neurotypical, or, as tragically many hundreds of millions of people are, who tend to suffer from clinical or subclinical depression. I mean, what is it today to be hypothymic? And one reason I'm asking this is so that it doesn't sound like total science fiction, the possibility of life based on gradients of bliss. I mean, for the luckiest hypothymic people today, essentially they still can behave appropriately. As my colleague Anders Sandberg, who's at Oxford, says, quote, "I do have a ridiculously high hedonic set point." He's extremely high functioning. He works in the field of existential risk. He's socially responsible and so forth. And yet his default setting is just so much higher than most people. Now, unlike pain, one can't point to a single gene that is a kind of that is a volume knob for hedonic set point, but nonetheless there are a number of genes that medical geneticists are teasing out that modulate hedonic set point. And the question is, if you think it is right to have kids, should you just just roll the genetic dice and hope for the best, or should you choose benign variants for your future children? I mean, the COMT gene, for example, catechol, O-methyl transferase, two main variants. One is associated with relatively high, and the other with a low hedonic set point. Which should one choose for one's offspring? And essentially, what I would urge is that all prospective parents worldwide should be given access to pre-implantation genetic screening and counselling, and in future, at least after trials, also access to CRISPR kind of genome editing. So in a sense, they should be able to choose in broad outline the genetic, psychological, behavioural makeup of their kids. And as this happens, I would anticipate that with time, there is going to be a change in the nature of selection pressure insofar as, imagine if you could choose that right now the hedonic range and approximate hedonic set point for your future kids. What settings would you use if, from minus 10, despair to hedonic zero, sort of emotionally neutral to plus 10, bliss. What kind of approximate hedonic set point and hedonic range would you want? And with time, I would anticipate there is going to be selection pressure in favor of ratcheting up hedonic set points and hedonic range. And if you're interested in the more speculative sci-fi elements here, and transhumanists can be pretty far out. I think as we actually understand the neurochemistry of reward and gain mastery over the pleasure pain access, in practice we're going to go far, far beyond today's plus 10. If you think of plus 10 as the most wonderful peak experience you've ever had in your life, imagine if we decide to create a civilization with the kind of hedonic range of plus 70 to a plus 100. The reason I give those rather arbitrary numbers is to stress that one can still have immense hedonic contrast, hedonic range, and yet the default setting can be incredibly higher. Now, it's very unintuitive. People will say such things as, well, surely you need to have pain, suffering, misery, and disappointment, that happiness, sadness, essentially they're relative. But sadly, as we know today from the existence of clinical, subclinical depression, there are some people who spend almost their entire lives below hedonic zero, that they experience gradients of misery, whether information sensitive or others. But essentially, what I think we really ought to be doing is a long-term goal, aiming for a civilization based on information sensitive gradients of well-being. Now, for now at least, one can forget about the really kind of speculative, far-off stuff about post-humans, sort of enjoying gradients of superhuman bliss or something. If one focuses on the next few decades, should we continue the existing system of reproduction, or should we aim for a more civilized, responsible parenthood approach? Other objections people are likely to make, well, what about costs? Won't this be horrendously expensive? Won't only the elite benefit? In practice, the costs are coming crashing down. Having universal screening will be extremely cost effective for all sorts of reasons. First, it will catch all the well-known, recognized genetic diseases, and which tremendous burden on the economy. But depression itself, in narrowly financial terms is a tremendous economic burden too. So it would be extremely cost effective too. And yeah, the price is collapsing. Pre-implantation genetic screening is most commonly used not in the West, but in India and China, though sadly for not for reasons one would necessarily support, i.e. it's more commonly done for gender selection. But yeah, in principle, all future life can be designed. Of course, genetic screening, counselling, design of babies, all sorts of other attributes can be chosen too. And yes, good heavens, this is a terrible minefield. In the case of the notorious CRISPR babies in China. Now, the
David, could you just explain what that acronym means, CRISPR, for us, please?
Yeah, essentially, so this is a technology that allows genome editing. Before, it was extremely technically challenging to do so, but this essentially makes it possible for routinely scientists to edit the actual genetic source code and choose the individual, the genetic makeup of new organisms. A genome editing is a tremendously powerful technology. And it can be also used in conjunction with synthetic gene drives to reprogram entire species too in the wild, which is if anyone is interested in the issue of wild animal suffering, we can discuss this. I wasn't going to make this the focus of our chat today, but a combination of CRISPR genome editing and the use of synthetic gene drives allows one to choose, for example, the pain sensitivity and hedonic set points of entire species, even if the particular characteristic trait in question would actually, in normal circumstances, carry a fitness cost for the individual, which sounds illiterate. But CRISPR-based genetic gene drives are first going to be used probably to eliminate vector-borne disease like malaria and so forth. And if you can arrange that all the offspring of a mosquito released are going to be of the same gender, it's possible to drive the Anopheles mosquito to extinction. But one can actually use this remotely to change the characteristics of entire species. China and the first CRISPR babies. The pretext used by the scientist in question was that he wanted to ensure that the kids were protected against HIV, which sounds admirable enough. However, the genetic modification he made in so-called animal models also enhances cognition, memory, and I suspect, though I don't know, this is just a hypothesis, that rather than being naive and this being a freakish coincidence, that really what he was trying to do was to create babies with essentially high IQ. I don't know this, but there's a lot we don't know about the circumstances. And this illustrates the kind of pitfalls and dilemmas. For example, I think we have an exceptionally impoverished conception of what intelligence is, that IQ tests measure only the so-called autistic mind-blind conception of intelligence. And if parents start wanting to have high IQ babies, they're also likely to be producing a lot of super Aspergers. Now, I stress I'm not being, judgmental here, but there are profound ethical worries here. What is the optional, not merely IQ for a civilization, but AQ? Whereas where AQ is Asperger's or autism quotient. It can be approximately measured. And one consequence of, in a naive way, ratcheting up IQ would also be to ratchet up AQ too. However, as I said, my primary focus is on the problem of suffering, mood, pain sensitivity, and these are amenable to genetic control. What else do I want to say? I promised that I wouldn't go off on a shopping list of all the ways I would like to see our civilization change so that we can minimize, prevent, and ultimately abolish suffering. You know, everything from basic income to universal healthcare to social justice. For me at least, the problem of animal agriculture, factory farming, and slaughterhouses is a stain on our civilization. And before embarking on, you know, the really kind of high-tech route for getting rid of suffering, let's get rid of the worst, most appalling injustices and shut factory farms and slaughterhouses. Okay. As I said, rather than my keep on talking, what I really wanted to do is to open up the discussion. I probably sounded, this is it, I've glossed over all the kind of the technical obstacles. Anyone who's thinking, doesn't that sound incredibly kind of facile, simplistic? Haven't you considered all the things that can go wrong? All sorts of things can and will go wrong, but this is it. Genetic experimentation, which is what we're doing, today with these, you know, unique untested genetic experiments, leads to all kinds of horrors. So the question, I think, isn't whether can things go wrong, but how can we minimize, mitigate risks, disaster planning, weighing risk reward ratios. I throw open now the discussion.
David, thank you very much. I mean, what you've said already is absolutely fascinating, I'm sure, certainly to me, and I'm sure to everyone here today. And it does open up you've kind of answered some of the obvious questions already, but I'm sure we can explore them in a bit more detail. Okay, a few hands are going up, but I want to, I'm just going to read out what's, Everard has actually put a couple of questions in the chat room at the moment. So he's saying, number one, I heard, I forget where, it might be here, say that high achievers, both in art and science, tend to be depressives. If so, could this project reduce such creativity in the race as a whole? That's a good one, David. Do you have any comment on
The high achievers tend not to be people with unipolar depression. The high achievers in the arts, so less in the sciences, tend to be people who are bipolar. Does a kind of genetic revolution of designer babies involve reducing diversity? Well, in principle, one can actually have more genetic diversity if one is prepared to edit the germline, because one can create genes, allelic combinations that would be impossible in nature because they would involve crossing fitness gaps. But in terms of specifically of the, the arts, I think there are a number of possible responses here. For a start, molecular biology can tease out the signature of aesthetic experience, beauty in the brain, and massively amplify it such that it'd be possible to have forms of superhuman beauty that are far more sublime than anything accessible today. As we're witnessing a revolution in AI too, it would be a profound result in computer science and AI if it were shown that, in some sense, the raw fields of experience were indispensable to any form of artistic creation. That's something to consider. Also, too, critical to the artistic creativity of many people who bipolar is this fluctuation of mood. But when I was talking earlier about how it's possible to ratchet up hedonic range, so long as one retains informational sensitivity, then creativity is possible. The enemy of creativity, critical insight, productivity, it's not being either extremely happy or extremely sad. It's loss of information sensitivity, which is why people who are indiscriminately manic, you know, just pathologically manic or euphoric, don't tend to achieve much, and nor do people, tragically, who are just unipolar depressive. So, yeah, if hedonic range is ratcheted up intelligently, we will actually see, I would imagine, an explosion in the creative arts.
Okay. Everard's second point was this: Scottish vegan school teachers notwithstanding, I assume that concern for others is somewhat linked to having experiences suffering in oneself. I'm out of my depth here, so that assumption might be wrong, I realise. If so, could this project create a society of completely self-centred people?
Yes, that is one risk to consider. One has to consider what kinds of well-being one wants to create. Consider, for example, a recreational or standardly used recreationally, a drug like MDMA ecstasy, which induces both euphoria, but also tremendous upwelling of empathy and compassion. Now, MDMA itself isn't sustainable. It's potentially neurotoxic. I'm certainly not urging people to go out and taking MDMA, but it highlights how, in principle at any rate, it is possible to create states of empathetic bliss. Once again, what is absolutely critical is information sensitivity. Otherwise, essentially civilization can't function. It wouldn't be ecologically stable. All kinds of dilemmas here. Something like bereavement, people would say, surely it's important that we can suffer, otherwise it would cheapen and diminish all forms of human relationships. That sure, one day we may defeat death and aging, but that's a long way in the future still. To which I respond is that, is it? I would want my death or misfortune to diminish the well-being of friends and family, but I wouldn't. I don't think I'm entitled to want them to suffer. And so, a diminished well-being, but not suffering. But this is one thing that a civilized information signaling system can retain.
Okay, thank you very much. We've got five or six hands gone up. I just want to say very briefly something that came into my head then, David. I've only recently qualified as a therapeutic counsellor, and it sounds as though you're about to put me out of business.
I wish.
But that was just a slightly tongue-in-cheek remark. Let's go to Aaron, I think is the first one. So Aaron, I've unmuted you. So what's your question?
Hello. Yes, thank you ever so much. I want to raise sexuality and the question of gay people. You could surmise that gay people, because they don't reproduce, are an abnormality in society, would we want to eradicate this? Or on the flip side, would we want more of them in order to reduce the population down a bit?
Yeah, this is one of the kind of thorny issues, given the sadly residual, and in some societies, not so residual prejudice against gay people. Would this involve essentially parents choosing the sexuality of their kids, leading to the demise of homosexuality or bisexuality? But on the other hand, the reproductive revolution will also mean that gay people can readily have kids rather than adopt, for example. Obviously, ideally one would hope for a society that would banish these primitive forms of prejudice, escaping traditional binary gender roles. In the case of flies, flipping a genetic switch can actually change gay into straight behavior and vice versa. It would be interesting to explore such technologies with humans too, though it might be disconcerting. There are clearly risks here. On a thornier issue too. This is something one normally avoids, but something like sort of paedophilia at the moment. Essentially when parents have kids, they don't know whether their kid is going to be gay, straight, bi, paedophilic, or some other form of paraphilia or something. One isn't doing a kid any favors by giving the kid a kind of orientation that is socially unacceptable and they won't be able to express without terrible bad consequences for themselves and possibly others. Would it actually be good if one essentially, to the extent to which sexuality is under genetic control, if orientation were shaped so that something like paedophilia doesn't exist. Once again, I'm well aware of the thorny issues here, but yeah.
I suppose the safe option would be to make bisexuality the default, and then everybody gets a choice everywhere, don't they?
Yes, indeed. I can sketch out my conception of, the good or the wonderful society, all the wonderful things we could do. But the advantage of aiming to ratchet up hedonic range and hedonic set points is one of the advantages, at least, is that one isn't adjudicating between conflicting prejudices. That, other things being equal, even a bioconservative wants to wake up in the morning in a really good mood. And that by ratcheting up hedonic range and hedonic set points, one is, in principle, improving everyone's quality of life without, my trying to impose my values or conception of the good society on you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you, David. Let's go to Chris Smith next. Chris, I've just unmuted you.
Thank you. Very interesting. I made a little note early on that you would want all of these changes to be rolled out not only to all humans, but I'm not sure if you said all animals or all non-humans. Where would you draw the line? Let's take as read primates would be treated as the same way as humans. But where would you take it from there? I'm thinking all the way down to bacteria. They are a life form, and plants. I'm pushing you, but you sound like the sort of yep. person who would quite be entertained by that. But serious as far as, let's say, mammalian animals are concerned, where would you think the line would be likely to be drawn?
Right down, I would say, ultimately to multicellular animals. I mean, I don't think plants can suffer. Not because, I mean, I said, I take seriously the idea that some form of panpsychism, non-materialist physicalism could be true. Consciousness could be absolutely fundamental. But what plants can't do is they can't phenomenally bind. They aren't unified subjects of experience. They are, you know, individual plant cells are encased in thick cellulose cell walls. You know, there could be no evolutionary pressure for plants to evolve an energetically expensive nervous system. So I don't think we need to worry about plants. However, intuitively, it's, in terms of how far down, and sorry for being illiterate, sounds illiterate, down the phylogenetic tree, across the phylogenetic tree, perhaps one can imagine helping elephants. I know a few years ago I wrote a paper, a kind of welfare state for elephants, highlighting how it is will be possible to use technology to ensure free living elephants are happy too. Intuitively, naively, it's going to be impossible to help fast breeding rodents, rabbits, small creatures deep in marine ecosystems. However, it's one of the extraordinary things about gene drives that I mentioned earlier is the way that they cheat the laws of Mendelian inheritance, such in the offering everything from biased sex ratios to essentially the opportunity, if you make a genetic tweak to a handful of organisms, release them in the wild, then the desired trait can be spread throughout an entire free living population. Now, before embarking on anything like this, one would want to do trials in self-contained artificial biospheres. As I said, gene drives are first going to be used, synthetic gene drives, to tackle vector-borne disease. But in principle, one can go across the phylogenetic tree. Any sexually reproducing organism can be helped in this way. And it's actually going to be faster to help the small fast breeders than it is if one is just using gene drives to help elephants, you know, kind of slow the slow breeders. This is it. One needs to go into enough detail to show that this is technically feasible, but not so much detail it just becomes impossibly utopian. One critical response for people is, well, look, if it weren't for predation and starvation, there would be just a population explosion followed by Malthusian catastrophe. But anyone urging this just doesn't understand food chain, food webs. It's scientifically illiterate. But yeah, if we're prepared to use cross-species fertility regulation, yeah, one can regulate population sizes too. It has to be cross species, but it's technically feasible. In the case of large terrestrial vertebrates, it can be done with immunocontraception, for example. In the case of small fast breeders, it can be done once again with gene drives tuning sex ratios. I mean, all kinds of options are technically feasible. A lot of people are aghast at the idea of, well, you want to exterminate predators, they will say. Well, personally, I wouldn't be very sad if predatory species were to go extinct. But nonetheless, one doesn't need to sacrifice today's, this charismatic megafauna. One can use either in vitro cultured meat, you know, members of the cat family. One can use catnip flavored mincemeat, for example, or one can do a bit of genetic tweaking and change the carnivores into to herbivores, to which a response would be, but the cat, a lion that isn't chasing and disemboweling or asphyxiating zebras isn't truly a lion. This kind of species essentialist response. But, you know, are humans who start wearing clothes and go vegan truly human? And if we're not, does it matter? And I would say the same thing is true of, let's say, members of the cat family.
David, I just want to squeeze in a quick question, if I may, before going to the others. Obviously, currently, you were talking quite a lot about pushing up the hedonic set point. I mean, clearly, we've had for quite a few years antidepressants, which are partly successful and partly not successful. I mean, maybe you think that antidepressants are a fairly crude version of this. How far away do you think we are from something that would be much more effective at just nudging up the hedonic range of, let's say, depressed people? Are we years away, decades away, or is it just a matter of funding?
Funding comes into it, but there's been a lot of funding. I think the tragedy, one of the tragedies of depression is, and this is controversial view, but not entirely expected, is that the neurotransmitter and receptors most involved in hedonic tone and whether people feel happy or sad is the new opioid receptor, that we don't call opioids, mu opioids, antidepressants, because they have unacceptable side effects, unacceptable in all sorts of ways, tolerance, making people more selfish in relationships and so forth. But imagine if we had to tackle, let's say, juvenile diabetes without being able to directly focus on insulin. One of the reasons I suspect the limited progress we've made in antidepressants, mood brighteners, is the fact that, you know, this kind of it's the opioid system. When someone is given who's let's say in pain and given morphine, what they will don't say is, ah, the pain has disappeared. They'll say such things as, I can still feel the pain, but it doesn't matter anymore. In some ways, opioids are better considered as antidepressants with unacceptable side effects. I regard this as one of the big challenges that one needs to go a sort of indirect route to tackling a depression rather than focusing on, the new opioid receptor.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's go to Roger. Roger, I'm just going to unmute you. So,
thank you.
Go ahead, what's your question?
I mean, I think this presents potentially the most frightening challenge facing mankind as we move forward. And ignoring for the moment the ethical issues about how we can justify reprogramming tigers, for example, you also talked about exterminating the Anopheles mosquito and thus getting rid of malaria, but we can't possibly know the ecological consequences of that. And you've agreed that CRISPR requires rather simple laboratory procedures, so we can probably get around quite quickly to improving species that must be within our grasp. But it's also possible for malevolent agencies to create malicious modifications. And how about creating a deadly and virulent virus that attacks only people with particular genetic characteristics, say black people or Jews or blue-eyed people or black-haired people?
Yeah, and this is it. One can consider all the terrible things that can be done with biotechnology too, from the use of synthetic gene drives to crash entire ecosystems to the kind of nasty targeted bioweapons you describe. I'm one of life's pessimists. You wouldn't necessarily guess that someone who thinks our future lies in gradients of superhuman bliss is a pessimist, but I in many ways am, and I sort of dread what many of the things that are going to happen this century. But essentially, we've essentially now in a position to, to take a strategic decision. 100 years ago, it didn't make sense to say, was suffering immoral, because one couldn't do anything about it. It was terrible, but that was just the way life was, human and non-humans. Whereas now, as I said, essentially the biosphere is programmable. We've got to take a decision. Do we want pain-ridden Darwinian life to persist indefinitely for another, you know, hundreds of millions of more years? Or do we want to start, phasing out the biology of involuntary suffering? But mindful of all the, conceivable ways things can go wrong. So, disaster planning, risk-reward analysis, doing as many trials as possible. I'm completely with anyone who thinks that there are terrible risks. But, there are terrible risks at the moment. And, this is the nature of sexual reproduction. It's an experiment.
Okay, thank you, David. I may have inadvertently removed one or two blue hands. So if I have done, I apologise and do put them back again. Let's go to Paul next. Paul, I'm just going to unmute you. Yeah, Paul.
David, I was fascinated. I'd never heard of transhumanism before, and thank you for your talk. I was amazed. My question is quite simple. You've thought about it a lot. So what do you think the downsides, the unintended consequences are that would worry you?
In terms of are you thinking of transhumanist technologies in the broader sense, technologies to eliminate pain and suffering?
You said so that hedonistic threshold. So if you want to reset it and raise it. It sounds marvelous, but what are the downsides that you've thought about?
There is this worry that the happiest people don't really the problem of suffering is not central to them. I mean, they can be good natured and so forth. But they're not focused on the problem of suffering. I mean, so far in our discussion, we haven't discussed ethics, meta-ethics. I just implicitly assumed that whether or not you're a Buddhist, you're probably not a negative utilitarian. Most people will think that other things being equal, but we should give a high weight to reducing and preventing unnecessary suffering. But I think, there is a risk that if people are too happy, and I realize this is that's a tendentious way to put it, that they won't be as focused on the problem of suffering, and that though it's possible too that that we will create empathetic well-being, there are plenty of other forms of well-being that aren't empathetic, that are more egotistical. It's a complicated issue, because other things being equal, one might think, well, yes, we want a more compassionate world, but compassion alone is not enough. I mean, I guess I'll just give the example of a very compassionate friend in San Francisco. She spends half her life rescuing cats and the other half rescuing the mice and birds they maul. And I'm exaggerating slightly. What is needed isn't simply more compassion. It's, in some cases, what's needed is a greater capacity for hard-headed autistic hypersystematization. But nonetheless, there is a risk, shall we say, that I've thought of another risk, I don't even like talking about it, but in principle, if one actually understands the molecular basis of pain, suffering, and depression, this knowledge can be used for pain relief. It could, in theory, be used, and this is unimaginably depraved, to actually enhance suffering. And humanity's track record is such that it's not especially encouraging. In theory, terrible things could be done with this knowledge. I mean, I would hope it never happens. But yeah, this is S risk or suffering risk. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Let's go to Richard next. Richard, go ahead.
Yes, thanks for the interesting talk, David. And I think that's a really interesting area, and certainly there are benefits as well as risks, and probably a lot of those are ethical in a different discussion. But I wanted just to refer to when you talked about happiness and creativity. I think I get very edgy when people attempt to sort of apply a scientific rationale to art in whichever discipline it might be. Because, you know, if I think across music, literature, visual arts, etc., if you started to turn out happy, happy, happy people, that would, you know, purge countless fantastic and interesting works of art, because they're formed out of indefinables, variables, proportions of pain and euphoria. I don't think you can really, you know, art isn't just formed of a stereotypical idea of beauty. It doesn't just consist of beauty. There's a lot more things in the recipe. So I think that's one area where I'd really kind of, I think, you know, challenge the idea of turning out the euphoric person is going to turn out great works of art. I think that's quite a good recipe for bland art, quite possibly. But it's an interesting area for debate. Just a thought.
It's possible. I mean, we haven't talked much about AI, but nonetheless, just as AI can now eclipse humans at chess and AlphaGo and other more fields, I think it likely that AI is going to be able to eclipse human art and artists. Now, this is complicated because, unlike chess, there is no objective metric one can use to say this is or isn't great art. But as far as we know, yeah, it should be possible to use AI to create, yeah, fabulous art, fabulous music. But even more than that, you know, I mentioned how, yeah, it's going to be possible to probe the brain so as to create, yeah, superhuman beauty. I mean, just as at the moment, life has plenty of philistines who don't experience much in the way of beautiful aesthetic experience. If one isn't like that, it would be possible to engineer your brain so that you can experience otherworldly aesthetic experience. In front of a less secular audience, I would now be talking about spirituality. I'm not spiritual myself, but likewise one can identify the molecular signature of spiritual experience or God, and yeah, one could amplify that too, kind of spiritual ecstasies too. I'm slightly diverting from your question, but my guess is that rather than being the end of the arts, that biotech will lead to an aesthetic explosion.
Richard, were you satisfied with that answer? Did you want to come back at all?
I think there are great possibilities in AI, as you say, and technical advances. I mean, you know, I make electronic music, for instance, and you know, I'm 64 now. When I first started doing electronic music in about 1974, you know, no person of my age could afford to buy a synthesizer. They were too expensive. Now there's an incredible range of synthesizers and some very inventive work happening with creating, you know, new possibilities with that and new kinds of controllers. So people who use them are still looking at the human ways of subverting those machines to make them kind of work in ways that are unexpected. And indeed, the designers accept that, and they're interested to hear how people have actually subverted, you know, their musical instruments to work in a different way. So I think really it's that kind of interaction between technological possibilities and the desire of the human brain to be kind of creatively subvertive, really, in subversive in a way through using them. So, you know, I quite accept those sort of technological advances, but I think they sort of happen in parallel with a unique sort of human interaction. But it's an incredibly interesting area, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Richard. Let's move on to Phil. Phil, what's your question?
Yes, I think it's a fascinating area to think about and talk about in the background. I'm absolutely terrified of it happening in any, coming to the attention of anybody with any power. I think the things we've talked about all the different possibilities of genetic manipulation for nefarious reasons were all coming to play. I think it's like any kind of utopia, a utopian idea. The key question is who decides? Who is going to decide what actually gets implemented? Are you suggesting there might be a sort of altruistic bunch of philosophers and scientists who are going to decide on this particular kind of genetic manipulation rather than one that just favours a particular race or their country or their economic class? In practice, something as complex and initially as expensive as this is going to get more likely misused for political aims and not to make us all happy. That's a bit gloomy, isn't it?
This is countless possibilities for abuse. But I sometimes talk of the principle of weak benevolence, that although humans tend to be callous, we're not on the whole systematically malicious. That, you know, just imagine a mouse in Bangladesh. Would you want that mouse to be happy or miserable? That so long as it doesn't involve the slightest personal inconvenience, most people would probably say, yes, happy mouse, why not? One of the things that technology can do, it can massively amplify the consequences of even very small, modest amounts of benevolence. And, you know, just think how, this is anecdotal, it would need to be systematized, but yeah, you know, you're walking down the street, someone asks for money, most people will hurry on, but you're walking down the street, someone is lost, yeah, most people will happily give directions. Why? Because in a sense, the inconvenience is trivial. We ought to dig into one's pocket, help the homeless person, maybe if one has a spare room in one's house. But in practice, we're just not designed like that. But if one can exploit technology so that the inconvenience is trivial, then other things being equal, yeah, most people, I suspect, would actually support having, universal happiness. One thinks how, you know, today almost everyone who wants a mobile phone can have one. They can't have the very latest iPhone 11 but nonetheless, people using mobile phones in Kenya and so on have a model better than Bill Gates had 5 or 6 years ago. The nature of any information-based technology, the price trends inexorably to zero. So though probably, yes, the rich and the powerful will benefit first of all, nonetheless, the time lag is collapsing. So, yeah, I mean, if a world without suffering depended on heroic self-sacrifice, I would be very skeptical it would ever happen. But if it is simply a matter of really making technology cheaper and more accessible, it's a dangerous assumption, but I tend to assume most people are like me, and it's kind of weakly benevolent but not heroic, and that someone like Bill Gates, obviously to get where, you know, as fabulously wealthy as he did, he was ruthlessly competitive, but now in a sense using his wealth for good. There's also, on an optimistic thought, this competitive male altruism, whether it's the potlatch, where you gain status in Indian societies by giving away as much as possible, to the Forbes, you know, list of biggest givers. Yeah, I've got a fair bit of faith in competitive male altruism too. You know, I'd like to, you know, go down in history as the world's biggest altruist kind of thing. That, you know, motivation for acting is extremely messy and complicated. But anyway.
So, Phil, someone has made the comment that you're always...
I saw that, yes.
So are you reassured at all by David's...
I think it's a nice viewpoint, and I'd love to hold it. I mean, as part of my brain does think that most people are nice, like David says, but I'm not sure that most people are in charge. And I think in practice, the people that are in charge will determine how this is used. But I love his idea that it, David, sorry, speaking to you, I love your idea that you just make it cheaper and cheaper, and eventually everyone will have it like a mobile phone. Okay, thank you. And it's not really wind. I've got feeling quite good.
Okay, yeah. Thanks, Bill. Let's go to John Davison. John, what's your question?
Thank you, David, and thank you, David Pearce, for the very interesting talk. It's my introduction to the subject. I'm a complete virgin as regards to transhumanism. I'd like to ask the question about the use of CRISPR, which is in the wild in the USA, unregulated. Hobbyists are swapping edits for luminescent pets and so on. And the hobby has been compared to the hobby computer hobbyists of the 1970s. Will this open market produce any positive benefits?
Great heavens! I think the problem is less the positive benefits rather than, you know, will they outweigh the negative benefits? How should it be regulated? Even if one has, you know, pronounced kind of libertarian views, the thought of DIY genetic engineering, essentially it needs to be regulated. That sure, anyone, as the technology matures and interfaces mature, should have the right to be able to edit their own genome, and this will very definitely be possible. But yeah, I mean, what alteration should be possible? In the case of non-human animals or one's own offspring. In the case of the reproductive revolution of designer babies, like we were talking about earlier, I'm assuming, at least in Western liberal societies, that it'll be parents who are ultimately taking the decisions with the guidance of experts, but it won't be state directed. But yeah, I mean, one can imagine something like Chinese society with a very different set of values. I mean, they've scrapped the one child policy now, but nonetheless, yeah, one can perhaps imagine a set of central directives to what kind of children to have, and it would be dressed up, you know, an extremely kind of ethically responsible, very responsible parenthood. But yeah, this is it. Countless unknowns, but the alternative is some kind of enshrining in law the status quo. Now, if you think that essentially the world today, life is fundamentally good, human and non-human life, then you'll be loath to consider interventions that will change it. But if you think that life today for countless sentient beings, humans and non-humans, is actually pretty terrible, that one is probably going to be more amenable to radical interventions. But that, you going back to your original example, yeah, there are lots of frivolous ways that genetic engineering can be used to, or relatively frivolous anyway, you know, these sort of glowing, what have you.
Okay, John, is that all right?
Yes, fine, thanks. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you, John. Let's go to Greg. Greg, what's your question?
Okay, well, not so much a question as three sort of discussion points I wanted to make, really, and a lot to think about there. Thank you very much. That was an enjoyable talk. But the first point I wanted to make was this CRISPR baby that was described in China. I understand the scientist who described it was actually prosecuted by the Chinese for fraud, and this experiment, if that's what you like to call it, has never been published in a peer-reviewed journal, so I would be very sceptical about it, to be quite honest. The other point I wanted to make was, some time ago I took part in a debate on Harari's book, Homo Deus. I suspect most people know about that. He made a lot of claims about the future. In fact, I was on the anti side. And apart from all the factual mistakes in it and the sort of misconceptions about humanism, one thing I did when I was taking part in this debate was to look at predictions that had been made of the future in the past and whether they'd been come true. There are a couple of obvious examples, things like Brave New World and 1984 didn't turn out like they would describe, not quite anyway. But then I looked at, I don't know whether you know Tomorrow's World, this program that in the 19, well, it went on for about 30 years, I think.
I'm old enough to remember, yes.
Yes, most of those predictions never turned out to be true. A few of them did. But for example, we're supposed to now have flying cars, we're supposed to have water bicycles, we're supposed to have robotic secretaries. So I'm highly dubious about predictions of the future, because they don't ever seem to turn out the way they're predicted. And I'll shut up after this, but the final point I'll make is this. I really liked your introduction to transhumanism, because I've heard of it before, but I haven't really heard about it in any detail. But my sort of broad experience with predictions like this is, I don't know what your background is, but practical scientists tend to be much more skeptical than, say, philosophers or the public in general, because they know what the limitations are. Just to give you one quick example, sickle cell anemia is a very deleterious condition, but the heterozygote, that is the person who's got one of each normal gene and a sickle cell gene, actually is resistant to malaria. So there are unintended consequences that can occur from this sort of manipulation. Sorry, that was rather a long question, but
that's fine. Well, 3 points, and correct me if I miss anything. Yeah, the first CRISPR babies in China, though I said there's a lot we don't know. To the best of our knowledge, that was it, the twins have now actually been born, and there is possibly, I don't know if the third child has been born. I don't think we've any reason to doubt, the actual case itself, though we don't know. Initially, it seemed as though the Chinese we're going to welcome that, just as an example of, a triumph of China. But then the reaction from the rest of the world was so horrified, they backtracked. I suspect a lot of the ethical hyper-indignation was from scientists who were extremely jealous, in a sense. There were also very serious ethical issues too, particularly if the HIV story was simply a cover, as I suspect.
It was never published.
No, I think the reason it was never published was because, the Chinese Communist Party then intervened to, take him out of circulation.
Yes.
But I don't think it was a case of simply a single rogue scientist. I think he actually had a kind of wider support, and not merely Chinese support. I don't know that. I hear it, I'm speculating. Okay, your second point, Homo Deus, was this? Oh, predictions, was this?
Yeah.
The future. Yeah, in one sense, yeah, futurology, it's a mug's game. Yet when I, you know, predict that next century there will be pain-free surgery, just as there is today, I think that if, let's say, 200 years from now, there is still pain, suffering, depression in the world, this won't be because it was technically too difficult to get rid of them. It'll be because, for reasons I don't pretend to understand, that society has decided that they want to retain involuntary suffering. That, yeah, in some sense, one, I suppose, yeah, I'm probably sounding like a technological determinist, and perhaps I am. I mean, something like radical anti-aging, for example, I am pessimistic about timescales, but nonetheless, when effective anti-aging technologies are widely available, how strongly should one predict that they're going to be used? And just as today, a new anti-wrinkle cream, it will just be swept off the stores at Boots. Likewise, technologies for radical rejuvenation, life extension, I think once the actual technology is there, they're going to be adopted extraordinarily swiftly. I mean, this fundamental desire most people have not to grow old, and to a greater or lesser extent we can rationalize it, but not many people really, with the extra wrinkles, think, ah, good, an extra wrinkle, it's a sign of wisdom or something. So yeah, some predictions I agree, extremely speculative, may not come to pass, but other predictions I think one can be much more confident about. So yeah, a mixture. The third point, bear with me. Your third point I didn't tackle. What was the...
It was about scientists themselves being sceptical.
Oh, yes, yes. And of course, the scientists are frequently right. Yet when I, you know, sticking to my core competence of pain and depression, I don't think a scientist would dispute if one says something specific like knockout mutations of SCN9A abolish the capacity to feel physical pain. I mean, this isn't speculation. One can this is well known. I think it's more the scientists when it comes to transhumanism are more likely to be skeptical about stuff like kind of radical anti-aging, and even more skeptical about something like so-called mind uploading, which some transhumanists believe in. Mind uploading is the idea that you could be scanned, digitized, and uploaded to a different substrate, which I'm very skeptical about, to be honest. But yeah, I mean, people have different backgrounds. I would guess a majority of transhumanists probably have a background in computing or AI. I have a philosopher's temperament. You know, in the UK, you don't go around saying, hello, I'm a philosopher, but that is my focus. And though I try to be scientifically illiterate, I'm more likely to think like a philosopher. There aren't that many transhumanist sociologists. Someone like James Hughes, for example, is. But yeah, there can be a lack of sociological depth there.
Okay, Greg, did you want to
come back? Can I come back just on one point very quickly? This business about aging. I think that there are two aspects to this, seems to me. The first is that we're postponing dying of things we used to die of, like infectious disease, and being got by other things which are now becoming curable. So eventually we, extrapolating that kind of process, we will get to a point where the diseases are not killing us anymore, things like cancer and heart disease, because we've got cures for them. But there's a fundamental point here as well, in that humans, as well as other animals, seem to be genetically programmed to have a certain lifespan. And that is a fundamental genetic property, which is going to be much more difficult to alter.
I'd agree with you. I mean, I think really that what's needed, sorry, there's a lot of noise in the background, roadworks or something, if you can hear it. essentially we need a twin track approach. I mean, I personally favour offering opt-out cryonics and opt-in cryothanasia. Not because I'm convinced that post-human superintelligence is going to want to reanimate Darwinian malware, but today there's something almost cruel about telling people that science is eventually going to find a cure for aging, but not until after you're dead. Whereas if people are suspended in optimal conditions, I can't see why at some future date they couldn't be reanimated and enhanced. Whether our successors would consider it ethical to do so is another question, but if one is optimally suspended, it's essentially this I think Krauts has the possibility, the potential to defang death, shall we say. A kind of twin track approach there. But yeah, my disagreement with, if you want to call it that, is kind of some of the radical anti-aging people is more over timescales than the feasibility, because as far as we know, it's not some kind of immutable law of nature that organisms grow old and die. That we should be, it's not like this was second law of thermodynamics. In principle, it should be possible to reprogram biological life. I suspect the hardest thing is going to be the brain, that one can replace other organs indefinitely or even replace them with synthetic counterparts. But in the case of brain, nerve cells, memories, it's still very, very poorly understood. But even now, one can grow new neurons. They can be implanted in people with Parkinson's disorder to replace lost dopaminergic cells. I mean, I think it's going to happen, and dare one say it's going to be inevitable. The question is timescales.
That last point, David, you made has come a little bit late for my dad, and obviously for many people who've who've had parents and grandparents with Parkinson's. But it's an extremely hopeful.
Yes, I mean, listen, we all tend to lose
being able to cure that condition. We seem to have lost your sound, David.
I stopped speaking because I was interrupting you. It doesn't work too well, interruptions. Sorry, I interrupted you.
I think I'd finished, actually.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, this is, we all tend to lose quite a significant portion of dopamine cells during the course of a lifetime. We would all get Parkinson's disease if we lived long enough. There are experimental, I don't know how experimental, but there are therapies that replace dopaminergic cells in the brain that have been used with some success. In principle, they could be used more widely, but in terms of creating indefinitely youthful brains, yes, just horrendous complications there. But as I said, I think cryonic should be an option open for everyone, so that no one feels that they need be left out.
Okay, we're just about out of time, and I'm going to wind up in a minute, but a hand has gone up from John O'Donnell, so I'm going to allow one more question. But John, if you can be fairly brief, I'll just unmute you, and go ahead. What's your question, John?
Yeah, as you confessed at the end there to being a philosopher, what is your honest opinion then on how appropriate it is to allow this technology to be decided by the open market, essentially individuals, deciding on themselves or on their children? Or conversely, how appropriate or inappropriate do you think it is that the state should be allowed to intervene and control individual choice on this subject?
Good heavens. Transhumanists believe in all kinds of revolutions. Feature of our society I wouldn't want radically to change is democracy. That, as far as I can see it, at least for the foreseeable future, it's absolutely essential that one has democracy and democratic accountability. In terms of, you know, the balance between, yeah, let's say individual freedom and state control, you know, this is the topic for treatises. People, for example, with libertarian sympathies, and a lot of transhumanists are very much libertarians, something like a global pandemic as we see now just highlights in some sense the need for coordinated responses at the level of the state and indeed internationally, and the limitations of libertarianism. I mean, this kind of no man is an island, but as anyone with a sense of 20th century history, well, not just 20th century history, knows that states can be extraordinarily oppressive too. So yeah, sorry if I've just waffled superficial generalities at you, but it is such a large topic. I haven't got some ready-made solution for you, sorry.
Okay, David.
Thank you.
Well, David, you've given us an absolutely fascinating time, and thank you so much for beaming yourself in from Brighton. If people know where the reactions button is, I'd be very grateful if you could give David a very warm round of applause. Yeah, we're getting lots of yellow clapping signs there for you, David. So I think people have enjoyed your talk very much.
That's very kind, David. Thank you.